Grace and peace to all of you this morning in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to those of you who are worshiping with us online. We are glad to gather with you this morning. And a warm welcome to all of you here, both folks who have been here hundreds of times even, and visitors alike. We are glad that you are here on this first Sunday in Lent. Lent, the season leading up to Easter, it's a time of reflection. A time of repentance, a time of recommitment, so that when Easter comes, we can proclaim the good news of the gospel with joy and with renewed, deepened meaning. It's a time that we grow as individuals and grow together. And one of the ways that we grow is by giving to those who are in need. And so in your bulletin, you'll see an insert from the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance Agency, which is inviting folks to give in response to the crisis, to the war in Ukraine. So I invite you to take that, read it, and pray about how you are being called to give. And then, if you'd like to give, you can either, there's an address there at the bottom, you can mail your gift right to them, or you can give to the church, right, LSU? If you want to write the check to Amity and indicate that it is for the Ukraine response, do that, and we will send the check on behalf of the congregation. So either way is fine. But ask God to show you how you are being called to give to the crisis there. Today, church, we are beginning our Lent worship series called I Love to Tell the Story. Stories are the foundation of our faith. They give us our identity. They tell us what is true, and they invite us into our God-given imaginations. Jesus was a storyteller, and he leaned on the stories of his own faith. And the beautiful thing about God, church, about the God that we believe in, is that God is still writing stories. God is still writing our stories, redeeming and restoring and creating. And so that's what we are going to lean into this series, the spiritual practice of testimony, of listening and hearing and giving testimony. And that is a fancy word that intimidates some people, but all it means is telling the story of God and you. And so that's what we are going to do together. So hold on to your hats, Presbyterians. We are going to testify during Lent. So I invite you to joyfully enter that series and into that practice. But we're here this morning to tell and to hear the story of God and God's people. So let's quiet our minds and turn our hearts and open our ears as the 11 o'clock hour is chimed. Church, God has called us to this place. Let's call one another to worship and rise in body or spirit as we use the words in the bulletin. Sing a new song.
Make a joyful noise.
Let the sea roar.
And let the sky shout.
Let the earth be glad.
And let the children run and play.
Let the old laugh with deep wisdom.
Let the young listen, wide-eyed and wondering.
And let us worship and turn to God in prayer.
Let us pray. Journeying God, as we begin to walk through Lent together, open our hearts and our minds to hear your word to us in the wilderness. Call us and go with us deeper into your story as we journey with Jesus to the cross. In this time of worship today, remind us of what we know is true so that we can find the courage to meet the unknown. Remind us that we never go alone. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let's lift our voices to God in praise. We'll sing hymn number 341, Blessed Assurance.
Please be seated. So my son and I had the privilege of going on Friday to see the Morehouse College Men's Glee Club in concert with the Charlotte Symphony. And it was phenomenal, I can tell you all about it. But they sang a song that has stuck with me. And it stuck with Davy too. And it struck me, hearing this song, that it was a prayer of confession. The song is called Requiem for the Unarmed Child. And it had this repeated refrain, this urgent, repeated refrain of no more, no more. No more bloodshed. No more suffering. No more poverty. No more apathy. Liberame Domine, deliver us, Lord. It was a crying out to God, a naming what is broken, and it was a call for healing and for freedom from sin. Beloveds, that is what we do here in this moment in worship each week. We come together to the font, to the baptismal font, and we do that so that we can be reminded that God loves us and we belong to God. It's not just a time to recite our mistakes or our failures. Here in confession, we name what is broken before one another and before God. We name what is wrong, what is not as it should be. What's not as it should be in us and in the world. And then we lay it down. We lay it down at the feet of Jesus. So we're going to start our prayer with a song that says, "Lay it down at the feet of Jesus." It's one you learned a long time ago when we were outside worshiping under the trees. So you'll probably hear it and recognize it, but we'll sing it twice through. Church, let us pray. Lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down. Sing that again. Lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down. Lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down at the feet of Jesus. At the feet of Jesus. Now you remember it. Sing it as your prayer. Lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down. Lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down. Lay it all down, lay it all down. All down, lay it all down at the feet of Jesus. At the feet of Jesus. Together we make our confession. Gracious God, source of all life, hear our prayer. We come before you in need of healing, the healing of our bodies and souls, the healing of our relationships, the healing of our pride and fear and apathy. We know that with you, nothing is impossible, not even our healing, not even the restoration of the whole world. We pray that you will heal us and heal this world. In this quiet moment, we confess to you our brokenness. Amen. Friends, let these baptismal waters remind you that even when things are broken and not as they should be, you belong to God. God who loves you and who knows all about it, all about the brokenness, and who even now is working towards healing and redemption in you and in this world. Let's speak together the words of the assurance of grace. Beloveds, hear and believe the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ,
we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. Let's sing Jesus Loves Me. Sing of that good news as the kids come forward. Davey was telling me that our candle went out because the oil in there ran out. You know that? There's oil in that candle, and that's what gets soaked up into the wick, and that is what keeps it burning. So we forgot to refill our candle. You know what? That works perfectly with what we're talking about today. I'll tell you about the dirt in just a minute. Today's the first Sunday of what? Remember that word?
Lent.
Do you know what Lent means? Not belly button Lent. But it sounds the same. That's L-I-N-T. This is L-E-N-T. Not the Lent you find in the dryer or in your belly button. Now, this is a season called Lent, which is an old English word shortened from an old word that for lengthening. Because what gets longer this time of year? The days, right. The days get longer, there's more light. And so in this season of Lent, as we are moving towards Easter, the days get longer and the light grows. Well, right. The days don't actually get longer. You're right, Davey. But we see more of the light at this part. Another part of the world is different, right? Yeah. Yeah. But there's lots of things that you see at Lent. You see, what color do we see more in Lent? Yeah, purple. I'm wearing purple. We've got purple up here on the communion table. Flowers? We see flowers for spring. And Easter, we have a lot of flowers, right? But in Lent, we actually take some of those things away. And it's a little bit plain, a little bit more barren, a little bit more stark. There's some good words for you. Hold on, I'll tell you. Yes, I am wearing flowers. You're right, I am. But in church, we kind of take some of those things away that sometimes distract us so that we can focus back on God. That's what we do in Lent. There's different things that some people quit doing something. They take something away for these 40 days. And from Ash Wednesday to Easter, it's 40 days. So some people fast from something. That means they don't do it or they don't consume it. Like sometimes people give up their favorite food or favorite thing that they just love to have all the time. Come on up, girls. Nope, you can't give up school for 40 days. Good morning. You can come on up here. I'm glad to see you guys. We're talking about Lent, which is the season we're in, and it's the 40 days before Easter. To prepare for Easter. Some people give something up. They might give up something that they love very much. That they love to do very much. Like watch TV.
Never.
Oh, I know, right? It's usually the thing that you say never is the thing that you should give up. I didn't give that up. Mm-hmm. So phones, yep. Social media. I know, I did not make it all the way through one season. That's okay, we're not called to be perfect. Right? Some people give up video games, right? It's the thing that you think, oh, if I don't get to do that today, I'm just going to fall apart.
Yeah, if I don't get to go to school today, I'm going to fall apart.
Thank you, Louise. But when you think you're going to fall apart because you don't get to do that thing, that's when you turn to God and you ask for help. That's why people give that up. It's to help them grow closer to God. So some people give things up. Other people take something on. They start something new during this season before Easter. They start praying more or in a different way. Maybe they draw or they write their prayers. Or they read the Bible more during Lent. We'll see. Think about it. Some people give. Some people save money that they would normally spend on something. And they put it away, and they save it, and then at Easter, they give it away, right? So it's extra saving for the season of Lent. Yeah. Some people read the Bible more. Some people go to church more, right? It's a time to start doing things that maybe you have just kind of set aside for a bit. But it's okay, buddy. But the purpose of doing those things during Lent is to grow in our faith. And sometimes we have to do things to help us grow. What else grows? Plants, trees,
people.
Did you have something, Olivia? You forgot. That's okay. You can think about it and tell me later. Yep. What's the thing you were asking about? Where are all the, you said earlier just a minute ago, flowers. Flowers grow. I want you guys to come over here to this table. And these... Hold on, don't touch yet. Gotta wait for instructions. Come on, girls. Hold on. All right, so these are plants. This is a prayer station left from Ash Wednesday. These are zinnia seeds. Do you see those? Right? Your friend's name is zinnia? What a beautiful name. Oh my goodness, hold on, Davey. All right, so what do flowers need? Dirt.
They need water.
Water.
And sun.
And sun. You guys.
Oh, wait. Space and oxygen.
Oxygen and space. Okay, yes. You guys pay attention in school. Good. Good. All right, so I'm going to give you each a flower pot. There you go. Make sure they have the tape on the bottom because there's a hole. All right?
It needs to be a hole.
Right, but you can take it off when you get home. This is a peat pot. This is a pot that when you wet it, it'll soak up the water, and you can take the whole pot and put it in either a flower pot where you want your flowers to grow, a bigger one, or in the ground. Okay, you don't have to take it out. You can just put the whole pot in there. So we're going to take some dirt, scoop some dirt in. Okay, I'll let you guys do that. Yep, you can do your own.
I want to do my own too.
Everybody can do their own. All right, so take the dirt. We have to prepare and nourish and nurture our little seeds, right? Or they won't grow.
Okay, that's enough.
Okay,
dirt.
That's good. Let's give somebody else, Davey, let's give somebody else a chance. Here you go, Olivia.
I want my dirt.
Okay, do you have yours? Here, I'll hold your thing over here. Right? So we got to put, what if we forgot one of those things?
And the flower would die.
It might.
No, you mean it wouldn't grow?
It wouldn't grow. The seed would never germinate. That means sprout, right?
If you forgot to give it water, it would die.
You have to water it. The same goes for our faith. We have to give our faith what it needs to grow. So that's prayer, scripture. Keep going. We're almost there. One more. One more scoop. That's an update. Okay. And Louise.
Potatoes. They also died because we didn't water them.
So you got to remember. It's easy to forget, right? I am the worst at remembering to water my plants. I know.
And we lost two plants.
So, but you know what? The good thing, here's the good news. When it comes to our faith, if we forget, listen, hey, are you guys listening? This is really important, okay? That's enough dirt. Thank you. When you forget to, hey, Davey, listen. When you forget to water or nourish your faith, God always gives you another try and another chance every time. We can always grow, okay? We never stop growing. Doesn't matter how old you get, right, church? You can always grow, right? Even when you're full-sized, yep. Okay, so here, I'm going to put some seeds in your pot. There you go.
Can I put some in my
Can you poke a hole in there? How about that? Like that. Poke a little hole, and we'll put the seeds in there.
I like the smell
now,
of the dirt.
We do not want to water these until you get home, okay? Yeah, cover it back up.
Until they grow?
Mm-hmm. How about we leave them here? Up so that they don't get everywhere, and you can come pick them up after service, okay?
If I brought this to school and showed Zinnia.
Yeah, but you need to put it in another pot, okay, so that it doesn't spill everywhere. Yes, those are the flowers. Okay. We'll talk about that later, okay? All right, let's pray. Let's say a prayer, okay? You want to hold my hand? I'd love that. All right. Dear God.
I don't think you want to hold my hand.
You're dirty. That's okay. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for helping us.
Thank you for helping us.
Grow in faith.
Grow in faith.
Help us to pray.
Help us to pray.
Read your story. And love each other.
Love each other.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, Louise. Okay. You guys can go back to the parade ground. Beck, Davy, leave your dirt up here. You can get it later. All right. Whew. Okay. Sometimes growing is a messy business.
The first scripture reading comes from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. In Romans 10, 8 through 13, listen for God's word. The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. That is the message concerning faith that we proclaim. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
Our gospel reading comes from Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. Church, listen for God's word again. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, then tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, 'Man shall not live on bread alone.'" The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone that I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve him only.'" The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest points of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone.'" Jesus answered, "It is said, 'Do not put the Lord your God to the test.'" When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Church, this is the word of God, and it is for you, the people of God. As we do most years, we begin our 40 days of Lent with this biblical story, the story of the 40 days that Jesus spent in the wilderness. Scripture says that after his baptism, the Holy Spirit led him into the wilderness, 40 days away from civilization, 40 days without nourishment, 40 days isolated, vulnerable, and alone. And as we heard, at the end of those 40 days, the devil finds him and tempts him in three particular ways, which we're going to get into in just a minute. But this scripture is often used by Christians as sort of a framework or a starting place for the season of Lent. Jesus' 40 days in the wilderness happen immediately after his baptism and immediately before he begins his public ministry. His public ministry that ultimately leads him to the cross. Something about that time prepares him for what he must do and what he must go through. And if Lent is the season where we prepare to approach the cross of Good Friday and then the empty tomb of Easter Sunday, then we've got to make ourselves ready too. So there must be something to this practice of distancing oneself from the distractions of the world. That's why people often give up a vice during the season. We often try to give up something that consumes or controls us with the intent of turning to God in our need instead of turning to that vice, whatever it may be. Sometimes people take on new spiritual practices or reinvest in old ones, deeper prayer, fasting, reading and studying more scripture, confession, recommitting to involvement in church, serving those in need, and then the spiritual practice that we are going to lean into together this season, sharing testimony, telling the story. Telling our story. The list of those practices goes on, but the point is that we reorder our usual habits in such a way that it shakes us awake out of our too often mindless journey through our days. And like Jesus in the wilderness must have experienced, our own inner life comes more into focus, and our relationship with God and God's people deepens. And when that happens, church, when our inner life comes into focus and our relationship with God and God's people deepens, our witness to the life-changing work of Jesus Christ becomes stronger, both as individuals and as the church together. So let's look at today's scripture and see what it can teach us about telling the story and about moving through this Lenten season. So the first thing I want us to know is that in the ancient scriptural imagination, 40 was a shorthand way of saying a very long time. But it was also a way of resonating with other key 40s. In Israel's sacred memory, the flood's 40 days of rain, Moses' 40 days without food on Mount Sinai, Elijah's 40 days without food as he journeyed to Mount Horeb, Israel's 40 years of wilderness wandering. All those stories that we love to tell in the church, they put Jesus' words in today's scripture into deeper context. Because when Jesus responds to the devil's temptations, his words come right from the book of Deuteronomy. Right from the time when the Israelites were journeying from slavery into the promised land and spent 40 years taking a journey that should have taken a few weeks at most. And it took them 40 years. It took them a very long time. In other words, they spent a long time in the wilderness because they were not yet ready. Not ready to receive the blessings that God had in store for them. Have you had that experience? I would say that most of us have not had the experience of literally journeying from slavery into freedom like the Israelites. But there is not a human on earth who hasn't squandered or failed to see God's blessing because we didn't yet know how to receive it. There are quite simply times in our lives when we don't have the eyes to see. Ah, but that amazing grace, right, church? It becomes those trials, those temptations, those struggles, the wandering through the wilderness, not just the good things in life that shape us into the people who are ready to walk with God, people whose identity rests securely in the hands of God who walks with us through all those things. When Jesus spent time in the wilderness, he was famished. He was weakened. And the devil saw an opportunity. Now, this isn't a sermon to discuss whether or not the devil is a real being, a snake or a guy with horns and a pitchfork whose goal is to lure us away from God. That's another sermon. Many of us in this room probably have a different belief or different questions about the devil. But I think we can all agree, regardless of what we think about the devil as a being, temptation is real. Evil is real. Whether it comes from an outside force or from within the walls of our own human hearts, it's powerful. And not a one of us is immune. So when Jesus is vulnerable, evil enters the picture and tempts him to do something that every single one of us in this room knows well. Jesus is tempted to rely entirely on himself rather than rely on God. If you are who you say you are, Jesus, you shouldn't have to be hungry. Turn these stones to bread. If you are who you say you are, Jesus, then why not claim your power and your kingdom right now? If you are who you say you are, Jesus, then just do what you want. Call the angels to save you. Prove it. In other words, sustain yourself. Rule the world. Trust no one. Those temptations toward self-sufficiency and power, those are the quintessential marks of the human struggle. We want to control our own well-being and we want to control others. In this part of Jesus' story, church, the writer isn't pointing out how beyond human Jesus is by showing him as victorious over the devil. Though that is often how it is preached. It's not a call to look at how strong and heroic Jesus is in the face of evil so that we can try and fail to live up to that ideal. I want to put before you today that maybe it's a call to see the humanity of Christ. Christ, who is the human one. Christ, God with us in our flesh. It is Christ who is subject to the same temptations and struggles that we are. Christ, whose real hunger makes him vulnerable, who somehow has to learn, like the rest of us, that he is not an independent actor over and against God, but rather a humble creature. Made for immersive, symbiotic reliance on God. Jesus, divine. Jesus, human. Jesus doesn't clench his fists and punch the devil into the ether, though he probably could. We would assume that he could if he wanted to. Instead, he turns to the words of the story. The story that as a devout Jewish man, the stories that are written into the fabric of his being, he turns to Scripture. He calls on the stories that he knows so well, stories that have been told and retold, taught and retaught, stories that point to this constant communion between the people and their God. Stories that testify to his own deeply intimate communion with God. Jesus is quoting the old, old stories from Scripture in these moments. But I wonder if, as he is doing so, he hears them in the voice of his mother when he was a young child. I wonder if they bring to mind the loving temple elder who spent extra time with him when he started asking difficult questions and challenging authority. Maybe he recalls the time spent with his brothers, learning his father's trade and carpentry and singing the songs of their faith. In Jesus' time of vulnerability and temptation, he isn't just quoting Scripture to outsmart the devil. Church, he is testifying. He is testifying instead to his deeply intimate, empowering communion with God, the fountain of blessings at the center of his life. With his questions to Jesus, who, remember, has just been claimed as God's beloved son in his baptism, with the devil's questions, he is essentially asking him, does God really love you, Jesus? That's a question all of us wrestle with at times. And Jesus, carrying all the stories and the experiences of the people of God, he doesn't just debunk the devil's temptations. No. His simple response of Scripture carries all the good news of the gospel. Yes, God loves you. God loves us all. God is the one that we are made to trust with humility and grace, to trust for nourishment, for guidance, for care. Even as we too travel through the wilderness, every good gift in our lives is manna from heaven, our daily bread, for which we can and should give thanks and for which we can and should pray anew each day, presuming nothing, with empty hands and humble hearts. For the God of grace is among us, and God's own child, Emmanuel, God with us, walks at our side in seasons of scarcity and plenty alike. God is the font of every blessing. Church, that is the story of God and of God's people. It's the story Jesus tells throughout his ministry. He tells it with his words. He tells it with his life. Even with his death and with his resurrection, he tells that story. And it is your story and mine. It is our story to tell, not to prove or disprove anything about God. Storytelling is not apologetics, where you try to make the case for God and convince people to believe. Storytelling doesn't do that. Storytelling reveals God. When we tell the stories of our faith, not just the Scripture stories, but the stories of how God has been with us in our lives, where we have seen God's love and grace made manifest, we point to God like Jesus did. Church, your faithful witness, full of all the missteps and long seasons in the wilderness, that story can light the way for someone else who is wondering, does God really love me? So, church, that is the Lenten spiritual practice, that we are going to lean into this Lent, the power of testimony, of storytelling, and story hearing. Both our own in this room and those of others. And I want each of you, before you go today, to pick up a journal for Lent. This journal, and there's this size, and for those of you who want to keep it in your pocket or your purse, there's the little size too, with plenty of paper. So choose whichever you prefer. And in it, you will find weekly prompts to walk us through the process of writing testimony. There's prompts, there's prayers to get us thinking and reflecting and recognizing our stories of faith. Because that practice can shape and strengthen us, giving us the courage to offer our story to others when the opportunity comes, and it will. And don't worry, you're not going to be tested on this. We're not going to make you open to page 4 and read aloud whatever you wrote. So enter into it with joy and freedom and trust as we learn together to tell the story of God's people in this place. Because your story matters. Your story deserves to be told. So friends, let us journey together. Alleluia. Amen. Let's pray together. Gracious God, because we are not strong enough to always pray as we should, you provide Christ, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit to intercede for us in power. Trusting that, we ask you to hear our prayers this morning. We pray today for your creation. You entrusted the earth to the human race, but we disrupt its wholeness with violence, and we corrupt it with our greed. Lord, soften our hearts to keep us from destroying what you have made and called good, so that our children's children can inherit lands and seas brimming with life and beauty. Loving God, we pray today for the people of the world. Preserve the people of every nation, including our own. Keep them from tyrants who seek the power to control and destroy. And Lord, open our eyes when we begin to turn down that path ourselves. Heal the people of the world from disease. Protect them in disaster and war and famine. Lord, help all people, all children, walk in the ways that lead to peace. And God, we pray today for Charlotte. Lord, heal the rifts and the fear caused by violence and racism in our streets and schools. Protect all of our city's children and give them lives of safety, hope, and joy. Surround them with people to tell them the story of you and of your people. Lord, we pray today for our country. Give wisdom to those who govern. Keep safe those who protect us from danger. And keep each citizen of this country protected from others who mean them harm. Form us as a nation, Lord, where justice flows like life-giving water. Lord, we pray for this church. Strengthen each person who is a part of Amity or connected to Amity in some way. Sustain them. Give them the energy of your Holy Spirit so they can tell your story and give others new life and hope. Lord, this morning be close to those in our community who are sick and to those who grieve. Help us to trust that your love is stronger than death, that the resurrection of Jesus means we will live too. Be close to those who cannot be here this morning for all kinds of reasons, and hold us together in close communion with you. God of community, hear this community of faith. Speak to you the names and the situations that we want to give to you in prayer today. For Barbara. Go ahead. Lord, we pray these things in the mystery of the Holy Spirit and through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ who gave us our family prayer, which we pray together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Today would have been my grandmother's 96th birthday. It is her first birthday in heaven, and I trust that she is with our Lord. My grandmother was a great Christian influence in my life. I saw her at least once a year, usually around Easter, and she found great delight in her family, and her visits were always a fun and special occasion. And in my 20s, I lived with her for a few years, and even then, we enjoyed services at her church on Sundays. I invite you to give today in the hope that Amity will share God's love with our entire community, the young and the elderly, regardless of color or creed, and strengthen our faith. Since we are not passing the offering plate right now for COVID safety reasons, you can give to God online through our website or in the offering plate at the back of the sanctuary as you leave. Give to God with joy. And as Matthew 6, verses 19 through 21 says, "Do not store for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also."
Eyes, as we sing together, "Shout to the North," which is found on your insert in your bulletin.
Of the great and glorious King.
Friends, remember to grab a Lenten journal before you go. They're up here and back there. And during Lent, we're going to sing a new song. But following the benediction, you're going to recognize the tune, but we'll sing it twice today, just to be sure. And when we sing it, we'll be passing the peace as we go with the Hebrew word shalom, peace. So friends, whatever wilderness the Spirit has brought you to, walk in boldness as the beloved child of God that you are. Walk in peace under the shelter of the Most High, and walk in faith, knowing that Christ walks with you always. Let's sing together.
In peace.